Okay, dobry vecher. Good evening, my friends. Good evening. We agreed with Irina Tsukerman, a human rights lawyer, to have a recording in English tonight. We did one in Russian previously. This one is in English. The subject is extremely important to us all, which is human rights, our free expression, which comes with human rights. And is it really possible to put a price tag on those things? We are both of Russian extraction. So on my behalf, I have to apologize for improper use of beautiful English language and some occasional Russianisms that I am not very famous for, but I can make a mistake too. Irina, good evening.
Good evening, how are you?
So you are a human rights lawyer. How is it different from a regular lawyer that we have here as a part of our life in the United States?
My job consists of investigating human rights violations and advising my clients on laws related to these specific abuses. Usually in the international court system, but on occasion, it also relates to claims that can be litigated in U.S. courts. I also advise organizations on issues on what constitutes human rights abuse, on the burdens of evidence that are necessary to prove particular matters. On occasion, I can provide guidance to governments seeking to implement particular reforms or to address particular issues as well.
So geographically, what is your zone of kind of present? Where are you present geographically with those things that you do? Where do you work?
Currently, a big focus on my work is issues related to Nagorno-Karabakh and Azerbaijan-Armenia war. In general, I do a lot of work in the Middle East and North Africa region. Lately, I've also been covering in the following events in certain parts in other parts of Africa as well, Nigeria, Cameroon, and others.
Is it a tough thing to do what you do?
It's not easy. It can be stressful. It certainly takes a lot of focus and time to follow different issues in different parts of the world, to investigate claims, to do my due diligence and to make sure that claims are not fraudulent or are not being misused to push some agenda, some political agenda that has nothing to do with legitimate basic rights of people.
So what are the basic rights in your opinion? We have our American life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, and extending the same thing to a nation that does not have same understanding of those basic things, although they, of course, they are present, and nobody would argue that any human being has those three rights for sure. But many nations have much more rights by the constitution. However, those three rights that we have here, they are mostly neglected, and of course, it takes some financial burden to establish the protection of the rights. So do you think that like economy and human rights go hand in hand? Because my thinking, I mean, I'm talking a little bit, you know, circumnavigationally, but my understanding is that it's just a plain cost of maintaining and keeping up with the human rights as it understood in, like from any Hollywood movie, like I object, Your Honor, those kind of things. It just costs too much money for a poor nation, right? They cannot afford it. Is there any other obstacles for that?
I think there is a lot of confusion on what is and isn't a human right. I don't think we are going to argue that if, you know, different countries have different constitutions, that does not necessarily make one country worse or more abusive than the other. The issue generally is that some of the worst human rights abuses have perfectly legitimate constitutions that actually sound even better than the United States. But they don't, these are usually orderless, abusive, corrupt societies that don't follow their own systems well. My issue is not with a particular style of government. If a country wants to be a monarchy, by all means, as long as they keep with their own traditions and do not violate their own system and do not cause problems for everyone else, that's none of my business. The issue, of course, comes when from corruption, from systemic abuses of power that exceed any normal understanding of how any such system should function. And inevitably, these things that start with internal fissions inevitably spill over into threats to other countries, because countries that are having internal problems and that are unwilling to implement changes and to re-examine the problems internally, they will inevitably look for scapegoats externally in order to justify what is not working and to distract people from their own mismanagement. That's my understanding. So it's simple enough. A lot of these abuses do not come from cultural differences necessarily, as so much as social and political unwillingness to confront clearly wrong practices that no one would really accept under any normal circumstances.
Sure, tyranny and the thuggery are so much more so much cheaper to implement in a society. So that is basically the I guess the bane of our human existence. Let me ask you this: women's rights here in the U.S. It's a big thing in public opinion and the in legislation and in jurisprudence. A lot of things stem nowadays from what is understood as women's rights. What's your take on this? Do women have more rights than men? Or are there any sex? I don't know. It's very confusing nowadays. So there are so many other sexes. What do you think?
I mean, look, on an individual case-by-case basis, of course, there can be abuses. There can be people who are abusing their power to subjugate somebody else on any basis whatsoever that they wish. Do I think there's a systemic dire emergency in the United States? Absolutely not. I think in women, U.S. are better off than at any point in time anywhere in the world. And that includes, by the way, Western European countries that pride themselves on human rights and may have more women in parliament and so forth, but that doesn't necessarily make them happier or better protected. On the contrary, I think some of the countries that claim to be leaders in human rights, actually, those systems are not doing the full justice to women as individuals.
It's amazing how our own comfort is taken for granted here. And for us who come from, how old were you when you were brought here from Soviet Union?
Or 10.
10.
10. Mm-hmm.
And you were brought in from Ukraine.
Yes.
You have any particular memories of being a child there in Ukraine?
Yeah. I mean, of course, I had positive memories of my family and school experiences, but I also had a lot of negative memories of Ukraine being a very poor country, very unstable. There was crime, there was anti-Semitism, there was poverty, severe economic problems, huge lines, shortages, deficits, and so forth. So there was also a lot of very unpleasant and memories that and experiences that I wouldn't wish to see repeated.
Do you think that, nevertheless, do you think that this experience of your childhood gives a certain kind of dimension to your understanding of the world's problems? Would it be different for you if you were born here, rather than have the experience of living in two cultures and working in sort of the CERT culture with your understanding of the law implementation of human rights expertise?
Yes, because on the one hand, there is that entire Soviet experience that came as a background to my cultural understanding and admiration for dissidents and that sort of heritage, and at the same time, a little bit of a burden because these family experiences of hardship, of totalitarian fear of everything, they become a carried burden culturally. On the other hand, when you're growing up in the United States, for somebody born here, I can imagine that they can be a little bit living in a bit of a sheltered environment, a bubble. And of course, any country will have, any person anywhere can have their own personal challenges and circumstances. But of course, everything is measurable by comparison, and also in part, it's on your own attitude and how much you think you can change the environment around you versus how much you feel like you're a victim of your circumstances. So I can tell you that in any situation, whether in a totalitarian dictatorship or wonderful liberal democratic republic, a person can feel either as someone who can try to do the best with whatever circumstances are allotted, or he can complain about how the world is treating him unfairly and wait for somebody else to solve the problem. I think it's more, I think sometimes when hardships help people give focus to their future experiences and give a sense of perspective. But that said, in both countries, I've seen both miserable people who gave up and were hopeless and just became drone-like in following a particular system in which they were used to function, and people who were groundbreaking and hopeful and entrepreneurial and willing to take risks for whatever they felt was important. And it's a matter of choice at the end of the day. You can't choose always what happens to you, but you can choose how and when you deal with this.
For a lot of people, a legitimate way out of their out of their situation is to immigrate to the United States. Don't you agree with that? Is it like it's finally going to somewhere when you are protected and where you can support yourself and you won't be robbed by the government, hopefully here too. But don't you think that, do you think it's kind of a normal way of the world where there is one place where it's much better and then the rest of it is kind of just a big slum and people fail, basically give it into the tyrant to the tyrannies that are in place for many, many years, and just they just come to the United States and they become totally, they reinvent themselves instead of working on becoming something in their own country and changing their country. Is it kind of how it will be from now on, that people would just migrate to a better place, or it was always the way of the world?
I mean, to some extent, people will always seek best opportunities when they can. And sometimes, listen, Americans move for specific jobs to other countries as well. Not to the same extent, but if there is a particularly interesting opportunity abroad, people will take it. There are expat communities in other countries, not because they can't find anything at all at home, but sometimes it's just a better opportunity at that point in their life. So, no, I don't think it's inevitable that people will never try to reconstruct their countries. If you look at Sudan, you had a horrible regime just recently. It fell. It fell thanks to the pressure from the people themselves. And now they're trying to build something better. And you don't have necessarily all of Sudan trying to flee. Some people are trying, and some people are staying and trying to create a better future for themselves. So it depends on how hopeful people see about the prospects of changing something. In Iran, you have a lot of people who want a better life. They want a better future, but the regime is well-armed. It is well-functional. It has had 40 years of experience of exploiting various divisions. It relies on spies, on support from other countries like China on surveillance and control, and it's exceptionally difficult to do so. So when people can, they try to leave, because at this point, what are they supposed to do? They don't have a way of even getting rid of their own government. So It really depends. I think there is no hard and fast rule. There are countries that are developing and people are just not patient and they don't understand that when they come to the US, it's not like they necessarily will immediately get opportunities to get a better life. And many people come to other countries in Europe, which actually where they don't find a place for themselves, and it actually ends up being a situation where they're poor, where they're broken, where they become disaffected, or their children grow up in criminal communities. So sometimes fleeing is really not a better option, but people don't see it that way. They're not used to investing their energies, and they think that their system is too corrupt for them to bother. They feel hopeless, and it's also a matter of attitude, or what, whether they're willing to fight for something, or whether they really understand that going somewhere else also means fighting for something. It doesn't. When we came here, it wasn't like we all suddenly became millionaires out of nowhere.
Yeah, but that's the plan, basically, of course, to become a millionaire. From what you're describing, what you do is pretty dangerous to a person like yourself, a young, vulnerable woman. Can you just look into your inner Indiana Jones and tell me what was the most crazy case? I wouldn't say dangerous, because that might be a very hard memory for you to bring up. But what would be the case that you would like to share with us, your kind of not typical day, of course, but something out of the extraordinary experiences?
Well, one of the experiences that I can currently talk publicly about, not all of them, some of them are still ongoing, some of the most interesting ones, actually. But the one case that is already completed and successfully was bringing an Iranian dissident out of Iran through Turkey and to the United States. It was crazy because the Iranian intelligence caught on that he was trying to escape, and it became very difficult, and they followed him to Turkey. So mm-hmm. Yeah, so that was really, really crazy, and it was actually one of my earlier cases in this area of the law. So I didn't have experience, I didn't have all this funding, I had to raise funding to help provide for the situation. I had to figure out as I was going and think ahead to make sure that nothing went wrong, and he didn't end up being arrested before he could get anywhere. So that was actually very crazy.
It's interesting. And who was interested, if I may ask, who was interested in getting him out of Iran?
Actually, primarily me. Eventually, the U.S. government came to assist, but only once he got to Turkey.
Well, fine. No, but you had no right to go to. You couldn't go to Iran, right? You.
No. It had to be done all virtually, completely virtually, which made the whole situation even crazier because, of course, he had limitations on electronic activity due to surveillance and other mm-hmm. factors. So it was very risky.
How smart do you think was giving Ayatollah's $1.5 billion in cash during Obama regime to Iran? What was the? I mean, I know the kind of legal foundation for explanation for that. There was some money that were given to the United States for purchasing arms during the Pahlavi period, and mm-hmm. then. And then it kind of, there was some interest growing on it, so it became this enormous amount of $150 billion, I think, of which some of it was done using cash and several airplanes. And this is an amazing movie, of course, if Hollywood would ever decide to look into real-life stories instead of other stuff. But what do you think, how would they use the money?
Well, I think it was very obvious from the start where that money would go. And I'll tell you, the legal explanation is not even technically correct, because the Islamic Republic that followed the Pahlavi regime was not a legitimate successor. It was not like Moscow following the breakup of the Soviet Union just happened to be carrying on some heritage because, you know, of some natural transition.
Including some obligations, too.
Exactly. They took over the country by force. They were actually a foreign regime that came outside from outside the country. These were not Iranians who took over the country. They were usurpers. So essentially, we were giving Iranian people's money that belonged to the Iranian nation to foreign-based usurpers with power. So it was not our money to release to these people to begin with. And that's aside from the obvious security issues. You don't give money to people who are going to use it against you, first of all, much less anybody else. So that's just common sense on every level. Even if you have a legal, technical legal application preventing a criminal or a terrorist from using it to attack you, is just basic self-defense. Nobody is going to hold it against you if you don't give that money to be used to kill you.
It's hard really to find any rationale for giving the money to your enemy. It's like at the minimum, it's like giving a razor blade to a child, and at the maximum, you kind of facilitate your own troubles. You help those who want to hurt you, who march every day chanting death to America, stuff like that. So, but when you said foreign usurpers, I was curious, what do you mean? The Khomeini was living in exile, right? When he
yes,
used the students
many of the idols were not Iranians, they were Iraqis actually, and they brought in a foreign influence to Shia Islam that was not original to that area of the world. They brought in foreign influences from various Islamist and revolutionary ideologies that had nothing to do with the version of the religion that was practiced in the region before that point. If you want to see what Shia Islam was before that, you would have to go back to a century and even before the Baha'is, honestly, to see at the tradition, you would look at how some versions of Shia-like ideologies were practiced in Oman before these influences seeped over there. You could see the tradition in Azerbaijan that was very open-minded, had nothing to do. So these influences had nothing to do with the way the religion had been integrated into Iran or Persia, if you wish, before that point.
Yeah, Persia is the cradle of one of the biggest cradles of civilization, along with Iraq, and this whole area is absolutely fascinating. It's a shame that people who are interested in history, like myself, cannot really travel there and see all the wonders of what is now Syria or Lebanon or Iran, Iraq. I hope, not in my life though, I think I'd be able to go there. Although, who knows, you know, we are fighting for 4 more years of President Trump. We've seen so many miracles done by him. Hopefully, if he would settle the stuff and was between Israel and its neighbor and her neighbors, he would settle things in Iran, Iraq, Mesopotamia, and it will be open to us to go and see how amazing the history there is and how hospitable people are there. In reality, do you have an impression that people are very hospitable there in the region? I mean, you haven't been to Iraq.
I have to tell you, I don't like breaking down shallow, regions and peoples into shallow stereotypes. I think like everywhere else, there are people who are tremendously kind on personal level, and people who are hypocritical and will make a show of hospitality for the sake of some cultural, paying lip service to culture, and then stab you in the back the moment that they can. I think like everywhere else, in some countries, you are supposed to be politely distant, but nevertheless, you'll see people trying to help you when in a difficult situation. And some cases people will serve you tea and sweets and whatever, but at the same time, they will not be sincere to your face. So I have to say, I kind of really don't like these words, honor, hospitality, the tradition is an action in sincerity and should be judged always on an individual basis. Even if the culture is not individualistic, the people still make their own choices at the end of the day.
No, absolutely. I stepped into it, I must tell you, because I am from Uzbekistan myself, and I grew up with this. It's true to me. It was somebody would ask you, is it true that people of Uzbekistan are very hospitable? I would have no second thought. I would say yes, they are. You can go to Queens, New York. You can go to plenty of Uzbeki restaurants. They will feed you. They will wine and dine you. Of course, like in any restaurant, basically, maybe with some extra zeal, they would do that because that's the part. It's a part of the culture, but. Of course, there are things that are, sometimes I think, why would not the understanding of democracy and human rights have the same, give the same roots to the area where, in Muslim countries, because they have such a different understanding of what a person is kind of entitled to. The idea of entitlement and idea of legal establishment of the rights. Why do you think they did not pay that much attention to that area? Or
well,
am I wrong?
First of all, not all Muslim societies are identical. There's huge cultural, religious differences between all of them. I don't know, like this whole idea of Ummah, it belongs among Islamists. I think most others are increasingly seeking to define themselves either by their tribes or by their nations and not by some gigantic meaningless terms that don't really describe how things are in practice. So there is also vast differences in how human rights are described, because I've had those conversations with my friends. They may say, okay, we may have long prison terms. We may have, you know, stricter parenting. That doesn't mean we don't respect other people, we don't respect, you know, women, elderly people who are vulnerable, that we want to extend them help or protection, or that we disregard human life as dispensable. That's not necessarily true. They have different ways of practicing it, but at the end of the day, there are recognitions of basic rights identical to all societies. There are differences in the way, in the implementation, in legal structures, in types of punishments. There are societies that are extremist. They do not value human life at the end of the day, first and foremost. They dehumanize other people. They don't see them as equal or as worthy of protection. And you will see the difference immediately. And you will see when it's changing and how it's changing, what they're focusing on and how it's implementable. So the issue is not, again, as I said, cultural differences, but whether a society is extreme in its assessments and takes those differences to an extreme, or whether they, or whether it's a different form and focus on particular things, but basic issues are still fundamentally the same.
Irina, let me ask you, do you think the United States here, America, knows enough about Nagorno-Karabakh and Azerbaijan conflict these days? Do you think people are paying enough attention to that?
I would say overall, no. The people who are paying more attention tend to be either partisans and polemicists for either side, or in lobbies and other interested and connected parties and analysts and who are interested in the region, essentially, or members of the communities and diasporas. I don't think average Americans are paying attention much to foreign affairs in general, unless it's something that they see in the headlines every day and or more or less concerns them in some way, like U.S. participation in some conflict or some economic issue that will affect the way the country functions. But overall, this conflict, I think, is relatively unknown. Most people don't really know geography well enough to be interested, with the exception of friends who are, you know, of personal friends or people who are familiar maybe with the Armenian community in California. I think most people don't really care. all that much. And right now, with the election period and COVID and riots and all this and that, I think most people are even more self-absorbed or absorbed in their domestic issues than ever before, in my opinion.
No, absolutely. So what do we need to know about this war that is ongoing? I think it's not, these days it's not as hot as it used to be about a couple of weeks ago, or it's still in a hot phase?
Actually, it's in a hot phase. The fight in the last couple of weeks, the fighting has resumed. Plus, there has been new information came forward through my through journalists who work for my for the publication that I'm working in. That there's now signs of a resurgent terrorist activity by Armenians in the region. The organization is called Asala. It has roots going back decades ago. They used to stage terrorist attack against Azerbaijani and Turkish diplomats in Europe and elsewhere. And eventually they kind of faded out after that period of time. But they seem to, there is evidence that there's signs of their presence in Nagorno-Karabakh. Plus there's now interesting idea that Armenians have been actually bringing in Syriac Armenian fighters on their behalf. And so all these rumors about the alleged jihadis who are presumably Arab and don't speak Azerbaijani or Russian or English or any language that they could communicate with the Azerbaijani military, and that these people actually may be Syrians, but they are likely, most likely Armenians who are Christian and who are fighting with Armenia and who've posed for pictures as a form of information warfare and propaganda, essentially.
Yeah, it's interesting how I just thought as you were speaking, I thought that how the fact was getting plastered over that a lot of people from well-trained people from former Soviet Union came to the areas like Uzbekis came to Afghanistan, and Uyghurs came to Afghanistan, a Muslim tribe with Chinese roots, and how the Chechens came to fight for ISIS and to other places. There was actually a big chunk of ISIS came from former Soviet Caucasus. If I'm not mistaken, of course there were parts from everywhere. But see, my involvement was civil conflicts, was a civil war in Tajikistan where I filmed a little bit and did some interviews and made two films for the United Nations, and I was told there by people on numerous occasions, I think it was true, that there is a group of people like just like in a half good Hollywood movie, there are people who are looking to get involved in military conflicts. All they know is to kill, and they really hungry. That's the only job that they would like to have, to be fighters, to be warriors, to be bandits, to serve for somebody for being paid. And in Tajikistan as well, they said there were people who came from Russia to fight for the Wahhabis, people from Moldova when there was forgot the English name for this, by Dnester River, the republic mm-hmm. that formed the separatists republic.
Oh, Transnistria.
Transnistria,
yeah.
Right. Sponsored by a Russian population there and with help of Russian government. So this whole movement over there, so you're saying that this is also becoming a hotbed of such factor that extends and prolongs and intensifies the conflict?
Well, yes, there is some level of globalization of conflicts going on in general. In the case of Nagorno-Karabakh, a lot of it is more information warfare than it is reality. The supposed PKK fighters fighting on the Armenian side, they're also nowhere to be found. I haven't seen any evidence except for mm-hmm. reports and rumors on either side of that. Mm. But the Syriac, Armenian, and Lebanese Armenian fighters, those are more documented presence. And it's kind of, it's illogical because they are connected to the general course by ethnic and religious roots, whereas the jihadists have absolutely nothing in common with the Azerbaijanis and would only get in the way in the best case scenario. In the worst case scenario, Azerbaijanis would kill them before they even got there, because they don't tolerate extremism in any form.
Yeah, PKK is the Kurdish organization, right?
Yes, supposedly Armenians were trying to recruit them to fight against the alleged Turkish enemy. Mm-hmm. But again, first of all, Turkey is not participating in this conflict either, and second, we haven't seen PKK actually being present on the ground. So whatever Armenians may have told them so far, it hasn't materialized into anything.
So the piece you co-authored with Jason Epstein in Newsweek was about the American interests in the area, because people kill each other on many occasions in many places in the world. Do we have a dog in this fight? That was the subject of your piece, right? So many words. And what can you summarize? I direct everybody to read this excellently written article, which is eye-opening, and all other good things. I mean, I haven't seen Newsweek for a long time, and that was one occasion where I read it with big interest. So can you please tell us about interests of the United States in the area and the players?
Essentially, Jason and I were writing that whether you are inclined to be more open to Turkish involvement in foreign affairs, or whether you're critical of Turkey and its policies, Azerbaijan has, it makes sense to support Azerbaijan. If you're pro-Turkish, then you know, it makes sense because, if you like Turkic culture, then, it's natural to support its allies. If you are critical of Erdogan, the last thing you want to do is him trying to isolate Azerbaijan from the West and make Azerbaijan feel abandoned and like Turkey is its only source of support. In reality, there are also strategic geopolitical interests that make sense for the U.S. regardless of these third-party factors, which is energy. Essentially, U.S. wants Azerbaijan to become a more prominent supplier of oil and gas to Europe rather than Russia or Iran. So, at the same time, Russia and Iran, of course, see Azerbaijan as a major competitor and economic rival, even as Iran is struggling with its own Azerbaijani population. So, these global geopolitical conflicts are a significant security and economic, it represents security and economic interest to the U.S., aside from Turkey and anything else.
And of course, Turkey and Azerbaijan represent at least within its better moments, they represent the model of Islam, that Islam is not going anywhere. It will remain a world religion. And their version of Islam is more tolerant than probably anywhere else, right? Because compare it to countries like I don't know, Iran, Iraq, of course, and of course the Arabian Peninsula comes to mind. So Turkish and Azerbaijani, which is pretty similar, even linguistically, right? They're pretty close. So mm-hmm. their form of Islam is closer to the West, closer to our interest. It's something that you would stimulate in terms of them doing it the way that is least less harmful. I mean, not harmful at all in many cases. To the way we live.
Well, unfortunately, Erdogan specifically has been, in fact, funding and very much stimulating the rise of Islamist extremism in Turkey and outside Turkey. But Azerbaijan has specifically not followed that model. It's not even a Sunni or Muslim Brotherhood type country. It's a majority Shia. It has Sunni Muslims who are well integrated into the country. It's very pluralist and very well integrated. It has Jewish and Christian populations, Armenians, different ethnicities, Russians, and they coexist well, and you never hear of any major problems. Yes, you have individual situations like anywhere else, of course, but overall, there's no government oppression, there's no systematic rioting or ethnic tensions of any kind. inside the country. So it's a very different story.
Yeah, Erdogan seems to be an ambitious person who wants to become, in my opinion, I just look at him, I don't know much about Turkey on the level of a like expert, but in my understanding, in my reading of him, is that he's trying to position himself a person who can become a player in the regional, on the regional scale, not just because of the enormous economy that they have, enormous skills and human resources, ingenuity that came from the history of the region. They picked it up from the Greeks. They were the basis of the Osman Empire, Turkish Empire. So there's a lot of history in the area that gives them the claim to be for saying that they're the best and the brightest, etc. But he's trying also to play in the, on the field that he has very little probably chance of winning at, which is becoming a fundamentalist in the mold of Afghani or Iraqi. So he wants to, it's not an excuse for him to do so. It just explains the vanity of this man, and he's absolutely a vain person and hopefully he will kind of fade somehow. Is there any chance of him fading away and being replaced by someone who's more
probably kind of... not anytime soon, to be honest, because he is very successful at stimulating different bases. He is playing to both religious fundamentalists and Islamists and to nationalists who would normally be opposed to one another, because Islamists are by definition against national borders and pro-caliphates, whereas nationalists are generally concerned about their own cultures and their national borders and so forth. So he's trying to kind of create this, use these divisions and differences actually to, and speaks different things, says different things to different audiences to a great effect. Now, a normal nationalist would say, you know, if you want to see a strong Turkey, then invest into the country's economy, become the top technological developer, become the best at industry, research, whatever, and benefit all of humanity, and then you'll be a leader and nobody's going to argue with that. But instead, of course, it's, as always, much easier to look for scapegoats and faraway projects, which include a huge investment of somebody else's, in this case, Qatar's money, while your own economic situation is unstable and your currency is falling precipitously.
It's interesting, yeah. I'm known for being a staunch supporter of President Trump, and I find his style of championing America's interests, America's economy, America's people, as the most remarkable way of standing up for the land that gave him basically everything that he has and everything, almost everything, what he has become. So it's different. It's historians may say fascinating. It's very hard to live through societies like this, where you have a person like Vladimir Putin, who also perceived as by so many in Russia as a champion of Russian people in the world, in history, and inheritor of those Romanovs, that everything, you know, they paint him as a saint, as a follower of Stalin, Lenin's ideas, everything. Like, there's no quality that would be too small for Vladimir Putin. And same more or less thing with Erdogan, where he's becoming this father of the nation type of figure and trying to become this. But they don't get along pretty much, right? The Putin and Erdogan. Russia and Turkey are not biggest friends in the world.
No, they've historically had their differences, their rivals for geopolitical and economic reasons, and you know, Putin and Erdogan had their own tensions on a geopolitical level. But at the same time, they're pragmatic. Their ultimate goal is anti-Western and anti-NATO. They've cut deals where they had to, and they've also been in some ways feeling isolated from the international scenes by virtue of being fairly aggressive nations that will give them a fair share of criticism and on human rights issues and so forth. So they've been promoting this victimization complex that they're supposedly isolated, no one else likes them. So they kind of have to unite against the world, even if they don't really like each other, have clashing long-term interests and competing claims. So you see how they do have that alliance. It could be called an alliance because alliances allies don't have to be best friends or agree on everything. We've seen the Soviet Union and the U.S., which later became implacable enemies, forged ties during World War II. So we are seeing something similar right now with the Russia and Turkey.
Yeah.
They're not friends, but they're certainly not trying to completely sink each other either at the same time.
I'd rather think about Hitler and Stalin before World War II being such friends for immediately before Stalin Hitler attacked USSR. So let me ask you one question, which may be an interesting point too, in terms of just regular things that you do. You are not too many Americans traveled to Libya this time. In our times, right? It's not a famous destination for vacations. You went there for work, right? You visited.
Yes, that's correct.
So how did you find the country? Not in the Beatles sense, but they said, how did you find the United States when they were asked?
So Benghazi, which is under the control of Libyan National Army, is much safer right now than Tripoli, which is, quite frankly, is not a safe place to go. And it's fraught with terrorism and militias and all sorts of factions and criminal elements and drug dealers who are kind of hanging off all of that. The Libyan National Army is rapidly trying to reconstruct. There is, of course, money shortages. The Tripoli government is extremely corrupt, and a lot of money quite simply has disappeared. I'm not going to say that LNA is perfect or they don't have those problems, but they are, at least you could see some level of results on the ground just by looking at it. They are building new buildings. They are trying to provide security for people. They are dependent. They are heavily dependent on the Tripoli. So they can't control everything. They can't control the outdated power plant, the power shortages, the fact that Tripoli is putting pressure on the rest of the country by cutting off power for several hours a day, just to be petty, just to put pressure that they're not supporting. That most of the country, including very tribal areas that are kind of they don't support the government. And, you know, when I was there, the GNA, the Government of National Accord, that's internationally recognized, supposedly, it was not present anywhere. There was not one single person from there around doing any humanitarian assessments or missions or talking to the people about their needs or providing any sort of coordination on security or anything else. They just were not present at all.
It's amazing how your profession takes you to places where a lot of people would never dream of getting to. And I admire and commend you and respect you so highly for doing this. It's really important, especially remembering how I would be admiring while living in Uzbekistan as a young boy and seeing a lot of foreigners. It's the knowledge that they bring to your world that is absolutely not to be gotten from anywhere else. You cannot have it from the books, from the radio, from whatever source, even now the internet. You still get seeing a real person from a different part of the world, for a person who's living in an oppressed society, is a big gift, I would say. And give a person really an idea how to proceed with their lives when you see someone from a free society living in an oppressed society. And my dear friend Charles Cole wrote a wonderful book called In the Russian Wonderland. It's about him, a young American traveling with American exhibits to the United States, to the Soviet Union in 1972, and how he saw this. He's older than I am. And how he saw the society. I was reading this book and I was remembering myself being 12, 13 years old, very eager to get to this show to see how people live in America. So it's kudos to you. Irina, thank you so very much. I think it was a very pleasant and nice conversation, and I think that the people who would see this, they would understand how the world does not stop working, even if America seems to be stalling a little bit in our election. But we will figure it out. I thought we'll talk about it a little bit, but there is very little really to talk about, because the fraud is obvious. The manipulation is obvious. The players are obvious. And the world is kind of laughing at us, including the people living in the areas that Irina is traveling to. They may live. They may not have a toilet indoors, but they would laugh at... I woke up...
It's true, because the U.S. is always proclaiming itself to be the champion of democracy, and the very same people trying to go to get to the office to displace the current president now are the biggest champions of human rights and so forth. But you know what? Before you start meddling in somebody else's system, however flawed, why not get your own house in order first? Because if you want to be setting and leading by example, then don't make yourself into a laughingstock that no one can even respect.
Yeah, it's kind of... I would disagree. Finally, we came to a point where I can disagree with you, honestly, and in good faith, because, you know, democracy is very messy. The idea of a neat, surgically clean, sanitary democracy is a fiction, and the people enjoy it for a while, and then it turns out that, you know, everything is rotten inside, and the rot should go, and it should be fixed from time to time. You know, even the best car needs some maintenance. So that's the time for American maintenance, and the garbage has to be taken out. That's how I look at it. I woke up to a...
Right, but it's the garbage that's actually trying to claim for itself the moral superiority, you know, to do that, and that's what I'm pointing out. Not that the idea itself is so terrible, but that the people who are trying to implement it and impose it and spread it, they should first make sure that they are the best representatives for it, or at least somewhat tolerable representatives, not people who completely subvert the very idea and then claim that they are the best ones to go and tell others how to do it.
Yeah, you get somebody like Biden, you know, Joe Biden comes and tells you to fire. I can connect things. I can connect the dots. Who would come and tell you, fire your prosecutor, fire your attorney general. And that is, in his eyes, it's his own self-dealing, masked as something that is decent and good for Ukraine. And Ukraine can teach a few lessons on corruption like any other country can do so. But whenever you get government money involved, this is kind of necessary evil. You know, it's like herpes. It lives on it. And corruption is, you know, part of it. Unfortunately, part of human nature. I woke up to a cartoon from somewhere in Russia. Someone drew like childlike drawing of a drunk in a Russian village and a woman who's carrying water in the buckets from the well to her house. And there is a bubbles with conversation. And the woman says to the man that they, have you heard they can't count ballots in Wisconsin and Michigan? So interest in Russians, life, huge interest in American, in all things American, is enormous. And I must say that as I was watching, I spoke about it in Russian this morning, but I wanted to say it in English. I'm just about to go to sleep. I'm thinking I will check this at this website and how much votes are there and this and that. And then I get a phone call on my phone. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. And I see the +7, the Russia and the Moscow area code. And someone is calling me. I pick up the phone. I say, what's happening? I have a few friends there, so it could be them. You never know. They call me from Komsomolskaya Pravda Radio. Komsomolskaya meaning Young Communist Radio. I must say that I kind of got onto the radar of a very famous nationalist, stupid TV show this spring. When I just started going online, a friend of mine called. He asked me, "Do you want to go to talk to Vladimir Solovyov on air?" And Vladimir Solovyov is, you know him, right? You heard of him?
Yeah, of course.
He's a notorious, famous figure in Russia, enjoying the protection of government with huge house on Lake Cuomo in Italy. Like, I don't know, $12 million a month or something, euros, billions salary. So he goes and he lies. So they want to go to his program as an American. So I went there. The question was the coronavirus, of course, and I put my New York pork pie hat, and I didn't have beautiful microphone and beautiful headphones, so I was sitting there and just tried to suck the air out of the mouth of this disgusting man, basically, who's advertising himself as a Jew, and he's against everything what I think is Jewish, Just an improbable, impossible man. You cannot stop him. He sits there like a spider in his in the center of his web. So, and somehow that got me on some Kremlin list of people who you can call. I just don't understand the logistics of it, but I got a number of calls from what I know is being Russian-sponsored media. So they wanted to talk to a New Yorker. And this was one of those calls, and they wanted me on the morning show there to tell them why this beautiful, smart America is putting plywood on the stores and in Manhattan, and why people cannot do anything. And of course, I defended our country with all I could over the phone at 3 o'clock in the morning. And they'll never invite me again. I failed to make a recording. They will never send me a copy. I said I only want to have a copy of what I said, but I was either about to lose my fire while I'm trying to, you know, play with the computer to record it at the same time, and I was on the phone, so I kind of decided I'll just do it. So it was fun experience, but they are so interested, and I went to the website thinking that they may have a file of this program or something. No, they never had. They don't have it. It's just a news thing, but the interest, the kind of curiosity that they have towards America, and they need not necessarily wish us bad, but they want to look good when we look bad. That's something that they would very much like to see. And also, to me, it's something that Putin and his clique are very successful at. It's like putting sand in the gear, gumming up the works, sand in the fuel tank, and other things. That very small investment gives them enormous returns, enormous, and they enjoy it so much, and they know how to start this all. So to me, Russian, how to call it, interference there, right?
The American
Russian
measures, yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting how it differs from our understanding what interference is. America's biggest interference in the Soviet Union was introducing jazz and skinny pants and rock and roll and stuff like that. It really kind of destroyed the fabric of Soviet culture. People didn't want to see anything Russian at the time. They only wanted, give them the worst American, they would prefer it. Even now, when the worst American movie in the Russian film distribution makes more money than the biggest Russian film. That's hard truth. So that's how we had this conversation, and we are both in New York. And tomorrow I invite everybody who speaks Russian, кто говорит по-русски здесь, to tune in into Russian.radio, also known as Freedom FM Radio. We'll be on air with Irina, 4 o'clock Eastern, Eastern Standard Time, savings time, Eastern Time, and 4 o'clock, the program is called Без паники, No Panic, with Yura Dashevsky, which now is a very good time for a title like that. So we're going to be instilling more panic in you people. So we want you to be there, and we'll talk about different things, not necessarily about what we spoke here, but we will give you a taste of what happened here the day before. Irina, thank you so very much.
Thank you for the opportunity,
good
I look
show.
Forward tomorrow.
Good show. I'm great. I'm so happy you found time, and stay well. See you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.